morning, everyone.
Well, this is like a classroom, right, John?
Yeah. It seems like everyone's
wide awake.
Get short of coffee.
Yeah.
Typical.
Anybody need IV caffeine over here? Oh, yeah, a few hands over there. We will speak to you later. Anyway, you know how they say that in the morning we usually have exercise and just wake everything up? So this morning we're going to wake our laughing muscles up, okay? Yeah. So, can I have a show of hands of anybody who went for the gastroenterology workshop yesterday? Okay, this joke is for you guys. Alright? So, where can you find a toenail in your abdomen? Think long and think hard.
I know he didn't mention it yesterday. Oh my god.
Yes, the answer is the peritoneum!
Sorry guys, you know it's really lame. We're all laughing, right?
Yeah.
Good sense of humor, guys.
Yeah, thanks for being very sporting. Alright, just a few quick announcements before we invite our honoured guests up to speak. So, there will be a picture-taking session at the closing ceremony, so please stay back. But certs will also be distributed then, so we hope to see all of you guys there as well. Please inform your friends who are not here that if they want to collect their certs, they should stay back until the closing ceremony. Thank you.
Okay, now we would like to introduce our first keynote speaker of the day. So, he's providing us with one of the most awaited speeches of this conference, entitled Housemanship in Malaysia. Datuk Dr. Jeyaindran, Tan Sri Sinnadurai, is the current Health Deputy Director General under the Malaysian Ministry of Health. Besides that, he also holds the position of the head of the Kuala Lumpur Hospital Department of General Medicine, who directly monitors the influx of housemen into the prestigious training hospital every year. This makes him a very valuable and extremely appropriate speaker to be speaking about the housemanship condition in Malaysia.
Apart from that, he is also a senior consultant pulmonary and critical care physician at the Kuala Lumpur General Hospital. Throughout his professional career, he has gained extensive working experience and postgraduate training worldwide in London, Dublin, New York, and Singapore. He has also earned a great reputation in the research arena on critical care research on pulmonology and cardiology, and has presented more than 150 published papers in medical journals covering the area of cardiology, pneumonia, and asthma. So, without further ado, let's put our hands together to welcome Datuk Dr. Jeyaindran as he expounds on a topic which, according to him, is extremely close to his heart. Datuk Dr. Jeyaindran.
Good morning. Nice to see so many of you on Sunday morning. And I don't believe whatever they told you about me. I'm a very simple person. I think, first and foremost, you must realize that one stage in my life, I was like you sitting on that side of the fence. And now I'm standing on this side and giving you a lecture on what it is going to be. I've taken the liberty of actually changing my topic. I've changed it to transforming medical training in Malaysia to achieve world standards. Why have I changed it? Because housemanship is just one part of it. And I think, first and foremost, I think it's a very laudable effort by MMI. They put together this first conference in medicine in Malaysia for 2014. It gives us an insight into both the practice of medicine in Malaysia and also the future of medicine in Malaysia. In fact, it's a very challenging time for us right now, and when I became the Deputy Director of Health about a year and a half ago. I'm actually a practicing clinician. I still do clinical ward rounds and teach students and postgraduate training. But I was asked to take over this responsibility because our country is facing a major challenge. We're actually at the crossroads of medical education in this country and to determine the future of medical practice in this country for two reasons. And you'll understand as I go through. Soon we are going to face the liberalization of trade services. And this will allow doctors from other countries to come and practice in this country. So if you're not up to the standard, you'll be pushed aside. And that is the biggest danger we have. Because with liberalization, anybody who can come from any country to practice here, including the professionals. So unless Malaysian doctors can stand up to it and you can deliver service that is at par with foreign practitioners, you are going to be marginalized. And that is why we need to have a very hard and strong look. Other countries around the world, even in the ASEAN region, have put carriers. In Thailand, they're very smart. If you want to practice in Thailand, you have to speak Thai. Really. It is a rule, you know, there. You can come from Oxford, Cambridge, they don't care, but you have to sit for an exam and you have to pass the Thai language. We are seriously considering doing that here, but which means that many of the Malaysian students ourselves may not be able to pass. You know, because it is a government regulation, when you're employed by government service, you must have a credit in Bahasa Malaysia. And we have actually removed that because of the shortage of doctors. But now that we have too many doctors, tomorrow I'm having a meeting with the Public Service Commission. We're seriously thinking of bringing it back. So those of you who do not have a credit, who come from overseas, unfortunately will have to sit for an exam and get a credit before you come. And I'll tell you why, and you'll understand why we need to do this, right? And these are many of the ways in which we can do. But if you look at Malaysia, in the last 75 years of independence, we have progressed in leaps and bounds in terms of healthcare delivery. Some of you may not be aware, but you know, our life expectancy, infant mortality is far better than America. And in Malaysia, one of the few countries that WHO says we have one of the best healthcare delivery because nobody is more than 3 kilometers from a healthcare facility. Many countries cannot challenge this, and we have come to that level. We spend about $22 billion looking after our people, which is not very much, 835 ringgit per person, or 4.2% of GDP, yet we've been able to deliver this. However, the sad part is, by WHO data, not only in Malaysia, in most countries, 30% of healthcare expenditure is wasted. So can you imagine, from 22 billion, we're wasting 7 billion ringgit. And why do we waste the 7 billion ringgit? It is an overdependence on many doctors and investigations which are not needed. Okay? Unnecessary prescribing of medications, not getting it right the first time, and it goes on. I'll give you a very simple example. A friend of mine had a Filipino maid who went for routine formula examination, just actually showed a little bit of fibrosis. First thing they did was order a CT scan. The CT scan confirmed fibrosis. Of course, we know it's fibrosis. But what is really needed is, for this kind of patient, the question is, does she have active PTB or not? And the basic thing is, basic principles. To a total and differential count, to a mental check, to a spiritual AFD, and all of them were negative. And yet the person went to a CT scan, get exposed to radiation, unnecessary cost, and then they say, we still don't know whether it's active or not, and you have to do the basics. So my question is it poor training? Is it poor ignorance? Or is it greed of the doctors out there to make more money? And this is my biggest problem. And the reality is that if this complaint came to me in the medical council, we are forced to investigate and, if necessary, suspend the doctor for unprofessional conduct. And this has happened most of the time. No? So you have to be very cautious that as we move forward, we need to produce doctors with high moral and ethical values. They must have high standards of clinical practice. And more so, you must be prepared to continuously upgrade your skills and knowledge as you go along. No? There's a famous quote from the Dean of the Howard School of Medicine who tells all his graduating students, we know that 50% of what we've taught you the last 4 years is going to be proven until the next 5 years. The problem is that we do not know which 50%. And that is the reality of medicine. And I've been practicing medicine for almost 30 years. In my 30 years, I've seen things come and go and change, and it will continue to change because as we begin to understand more and more about medicine, we will then begin to realize that things are different. Yeah. So with that background, let's look at how can we transform healthcare in Malaysia to a better level. No? Now, first and foremost, internship is the education of a doctor which goes on after he has his degree, is after the most important part of his education. And this you can see was said in 1894. It is not nothing new. So basically what I told you about Howard School of Medicine is very true. And what you also said is that medical school is a farm team, internship is a show. You learn a lot of things, but internship is where you actually prove it. So for many of you, you'll soon come to hear credentialing and privileging. When you pass from medical school, you are given a piece of paper that says you have passed the medical program. That's just a credential. Whether we're going to let you work as a doctor or not is the privileging, and housemanship is that privileging. And throughout medical education and practice, you'll have this. And you become a specialist, we'll credential you and privilege you again. And you become a subspecialist, we'll credential you and privilege you again. And as you work, every 3 years, you will check whether you're capable of continuing working and doing the procedures that you have been trained. So medicine is a process of lifelong learning. So if you're not prepared to do that, I think you're in the wrong place. That's number one. Number two, when we look at what I'm going to talk to you about, I'm going to talk to you about housemanship training in Malaysia, the introduction, the issues with medical students, achievements, issues and challenges, the way forward, and like I said, the easiest decision is to become a doctor. It is far more difficult being a good doctor. Now, we're actually at a crossroads because there are too many medical students. Many of them have a poor standard. Competencies are lacking, core knowledge is lacking, clinical skills are lacking, and we also have a problem of inadequate specialists. So if you have too many medical students or too many generalists, or not even generalists, but GPs or MOs, but the number of specialists is inadequate. Then we have got this big paradigm between subspecialists and generalists. Everybody wants to be a cardiologist, but even in cardiology, nobody wants to do heart failure, nobody wants to do atrial fibrillation because there's no money in it. Everybody wants to do intervention, want to put a stent in, because each stent is a down payment to his Ferrari or Porsche. We know that. An 85-year-old lady being stented 5 times. Nowhere in the world will it happen, only happens in Malaysia. There's no indication, but people will do it. And this is the people that we have to haul up, because we do not want black sheep in the fraternity. Now, when we talk about the manpower continuum, we talk about medical students, house officers, medical officers, specialists and subspecialists. I'm going to touch about this. So what happened was that in 2013 September, I called for a national meeting because when I took this job, one of my KPIs was to address this. So what we did was we had 150 senior consultants and specialists to address the issues of all of this. We had problems with medical students, we had problems with house officers, we had problems with medical officers, we had problems with specialists and subspecialists. Every one of them, we had a major problem that needed to be addressed. And we came with the Malacca Resolution in September 2013. I'm very proud to say that within 6 months, by the middle of this year, by March, we already had solutions, and we put many of them into place. And you will now see what the solutions are. When we talk about medical schools and medical students, we all know that you have medical graduates, both from local and abroad, from 375 medical universities, from 35 countries. Singapore doesn't do that. There's only analyzed, or maybe except maybe about 5 or 6 medical universities. We are very liberal. 370 medical universities worldwide. Now what we discovered was the variation in the quality related to the curriculum, the training, the clinical exposure, exposure to diseases, exposure to tropical diseases. If you're trained in Russia, Ukraine, you've never been trained on dengue, which is the biggest problem in this country. Different languages spoken in totally different cultures. An increasing number of medical graduates, especially from 2008. So this was some of the biggest challenges. So one of the first things I did was, if you look at the 378 universities worldwide, these are the universities that come on what is known as the second schedule of the Medical Act. So when I took over, we decided to write to the 370 universities worldwide and check whether they actually existed. Now, some of them were Iran, some of them were Iraq, we didn't know whether they existed still. And there's some other universities in other parts of the world. Out of the 378, only 125 replied. Now, among those that replied were some that we agreed that we need to look at. But some of them were world-class universities, Oxford and Cambridge, Harvard. Johns Hopkins didn't reply. So what does this technically mean? If you come from any one of the universities, you are unqualified to practice in Malaysia, and you have to sit for a qualifying exam. It is not new, don't look surprised. This happens if you go to work in Australia, wherever you come from, you have to sit for a qualifying exam. If you go to America, wherever you graduate, even locally, you have to sit for a qualifying exam. So I think that's the way forward. It's immaterial where you come from. If you're going to work in this country, you'll soon have to sit for a qualifying exam. And it's nothing new. All other countries in the world have done it. In the UK, too, it's the same. You have to sit for a qualifying exam. So it's nothing unusual. Right? It's nothing unusual. It is a reality that we have to face. And when you look at this, you can see the number of house officers suddenly started increasing from 2008. And we went through the roof in 2008. And you can see the number keeps increasing and increasing. And right now, if you look there, the total is about 5,000. No? House officers, they come, medical students that come back. And you look at the numbers overseas and local are almost identical. No? Right? The problem is that you have no full data of the number of students who go overseas. Because the government has stopped sending undergraduate students overseas because when we discovered this 2 years ago, the government took a decision that only about 50 students would be sent to Ivy League universities overseas to pursue an undergraduate program. Because we have enough capacity here and we are mature enough to do it locally. So this is what happened. If you look at Australia, they only got 19 medical schools. We got 33 medical schools and 44 programs. And in Australia, what happened, out of the 19 medical schools, 30% of the students go back to the country of origin. In Malaysia, we have to absorb them all because the degrees are not recognizable overseas. So some of them are recognized. So then, when I started looking, this is how we divided them. And you can look at it. We've got group one, which is older universities, University of Malaya, UKM, USM, UNIMAS, UPM, and IIUM. Then we have the IPTS or the private universities, and we divided them into various groups, older and newer. We did this basically because we actually did a study on the quality of students in these universities, and we found some very disturbing results. And the disturbing results I cannot present yet because it's still confidential, but I can tell you that one of the reasons we found was that entry into medical college in this country is 5 Bs. It is not very great, huh? Because every year 15,000 students get 5 A's and above. And yet the universities are taking students with less than 5 B's, so there must be a major problem. Huh? That means the smart students are not doing medicine. It is true, if you've got 15,000 students who get 5 A's and there are only about 4,000 seats for medicine in this country, why are they having to take students with less than 5 B's? So that is the reality. Yeah? So where are all the students in 5 days' wait? Obviously they're doing other things. Yeah? And probably they think other programs are more lucrative than doing medicine. Yeah? So that was the first fear that we had. Yeah? So when we looked at the quota of the university, these are the ITTAs. And you can see that in MU, for example, they're giving 200 students a year. But last year, they dropped it to 190. And I think this year, they dropped my device around. She probably said she wants to drop it to 150. Because they think that's the ideal number to have, and we've got no problem with that. But you can see in some years, the numbers are more than 200. That's basically because these are the failures of repeating. And so you can see that in this year, there are 35 extra students, which means that 35 of them have not been able to go forward or whatever it is. And that is how it goes up. And we've got the same for the private medical colleges. You can see that the numbers are there. And you can see for many of these colleges, they've given them large numbers. But in reality, they've not been able to fulfill the numbers. Why have they not been able to fulfill the numbers is because some of them, you can see, are not started. They've been given permission but not started because they can't find the appropriate lecturers. They're very strict. There has to be one lecturer for every 8 student in the preclinical years and one lecturer for 4 students in the clinical years. But this quota now has been found to be a fiasco. We're looking now at contact hours. My question is, how many hours does your lecturer actually spend with you in your ward? And the answer is very shocking. Huh? The number is extremely low. That is why it's incompetence. Not only from the private universities, but from the public universities. Because I'm the end result, the end user of all of this. And we know that some of the students have never examined patients properly, and they've been managed to come out of the exams. Yeah? So now we look at the estimated number of students in medical schools, and we did this early this year. You can see the data was from the dean on the 14th of February. I called for a meeting because I had to address the issue. And you can see that for 2015, we'll get roughly almost 3,000, and it keeps going up by 500 students every year. and that is quite worrying. You can look at it. If you look at IPTA, the numbers are almost identical. In fact, they're slowly trying to throttle down because, like I said, many of the IPTAs want to reduce numbers. But on the other hand, IPTS, because they're driven by money, want to increase the number of students every year. So that's my big problem number one. So if you look at it in a bar chart, you can see why the problem is. It's just going to go higher and higher until we do something to prevent this from going on. So when we started looking at the medical school intake, this is what I said. The total capacity that you have allowed is 5,300 students. This is the total capacity that you have allowed, but like I showed you just now, many of the schools have not been able to get capacity. So what happened was that early this year, a group of us sat down and re-looked medical education in Malaysia. The international norms, whether it's the DMC or the Australian Medical Council, mandates that one medical student is exposed to 5 patients. In this country, one medical student is exposed to maybe only 2 patients, or 1 patient in some places. And what does this result in? It results in my patient in my ward being examined by 3 sets of medical students in the same day. So if he's not ill, he'll be far iller by the end of the day because everybody goes and looks at his patient, not as a patient, but he's got a beautiful murmur, he's got a beautiful craps, and you're inhale and exhale, and the purple will be extremely tight. So you must understand that a patient is a patient. It is not a symptom, it's not a diagnosis. And that is why we have to limit the exposure of the patient to students. So based on this, unfortunately, the truth will be that we will have to reduce it to only 2,500 students per year. So that means to say, half this number will have to be X'd. Now, otherwise, we will not be able to fulfill international norms. And that is the big problem that we have. If I did it overnight, a lot of companies are going to go bankrupt. A lot of students are going to become jobless. So we have to do it over a period of time. So what have we done is that we have done many ways looking at it. First and foremost is a moratorium. The moratorium expires next year. But we have decided that this moratorium will be extended indefinitely. We've already had rounds of meetings with the relevant stakeholders, and we've decided that this moratorium will be extended indefinitely. The moratorium not only is on the number of medical schools to be started, but on the number of students that the medical school has. Some of the medical schools, the businessmen, will not start a new school, but they start a new program within the same school. So for that, it's also a moratorium. Some of them have a double intake. They take one group of students in January, in the middle of the year. Some of them have a training program at universities overseas. They're also limiting the number of training programs. And like I said, they're strictly looking at quotas. Because quotas do not reflect teaching. What reflects teaching is contact hours. And the most important thing is that sufficient lecturers for the clinical years, because there's some medical colleges that run College of Dentistry, College of Medicine, College of Pharmacy, and the same professor is lecturing all 3 colleges. It's not possible. Doesn't happen anywhere, But it happens in many private colleges where you find the same name across all. It's impossible. Because for most lecturers, maximum number of hours they should spend is not more than 10 hours lecturing per week. In some places it is more. Some of the places are doing 30 hours. During 30 hours, there's hardly any time to do any research, so it doesn't make sense. And like I said, entry qualification from 5A's, from 5B's, may end up being 5A's, and then the process of moving it upwards. Yeah, because we have to set the implementation date, and the date will be set soon, and I think the ministers will make an announcement once it goes to the cabinet as to when this will occur. Entry requirements should be similar to local medical programs and by MMC. The problem is that we can mandate local qualification. But overseas, students that go to all kinds of qualifications, because although there's such a thing as a letter of no certificate of no objection, it is a worthless piece of paper. So what we're trying to do is that we're trying to mandate that whether you go to medical school locally or overseas, your entry qualification has to be the same. If you mention that that medical college wants to take you with all C's and all D's, that's fine, but you cannot come back and work in this country. It is immense. Like I said, giving you a piece of paper is a credential. But whether we will privilege you to work is very different. So please bear that in mind. Getting a piece of paper from a medical college does not mean you are a doctor. It only means a finished program of training in a medical college, and not necessarily would you be allowed to work in this country. So this is something very careful you must look at. You look at the legal implication. We're quite sure that you can do this. Okay? And like I said, eventually we're going to bring about a common licensing exam. No? So if you look at John Albert Key, an English surgeon, Hungarian oration in 1819, I said, there's no shortcut or royal road to the attainment of medical knowledge. The path you have to pursue is long, difficult, and unsafe. So in medicine, it's a very long, protected process of studying. No? So when we look at manpower planning, we talk about housemen. Now we talk about, housemanship training. No? Like I said, because it's a large number, housemanship training is very important because it gives you the core knowledge and the clinical competency of doing work. No? So now what we have to do is that, if you look at the Medical Act in 1971, the minimum duration of housemanship is 12 months. Okay? And you have to do mandatory posting in medicine, surgery, and ONG. For those of you in overseas, especially those of you in the UK, these are not mandatory postings. So when you come back to work in Malaysia, don't be surprised, even as a medical officer, you'll be asked to do these mandatory postings before you can be considered for registration. That, unfortunately, is a law. Huh? And unless you come back as a specialist, then you are obliged, or you can be allowed not to do this. Huh? Now, because of 2008, we found the major problems, housemanship was extended to 2 years or 24 months, with additional postings, 5 compulsory and 1 obligatory, medical, surgical, PET, orthopedic, ONG, and we gave an option of medicine and anesthesiology at a maximum of 4 months, and a maximum of 1 year per posting. So you realize that if you are a house officer and you cannot fulfill your posting, you'll be extended and extended. After the first extension, you'll be transferred to a different hospital for an extension because to give you fairness. Otherwise, you say that you are being victimized by the consultants. So what has happened is that you are doing it in, let us say, in a hospital in Klang Valley, and you have been extended once, you'll be transferred to the hospital, maybe Penang, Johor, Sabah, Sarawak, depending on the vacancies. The problem is that now you have to wait a minimum of 6 months to get a job. Now, there's so many people waiting in line, you have to wait minimum of 6 months to get a job. And if you are extended, or you drop out, you may wait 1 year to come back to a job. Some of them are waiting for 2 years to get a job, no? And they know how difficult it is. No? Now, the purpose of housemanship is to ensure the competency, to improve the training, prepare house officers for district postings, and to cater for the needs of our country. No? So, like I said, no? When we looked at it, we started re-looking at adequate training norms. No? And many house officers will complain they're overworked. No? They're not overworked. They are not. If anybody says they overwork, there's something wrong. No? Because the current ratio is one house officer to 3.3 beds. The international norm is 1:8, is 1:12. If you go to Singapore, 1:8. If you go to Australia, 1:10. If you go to America, 1:12. So if you cannot cope at 1:3, I don't think medicine is a candidate for you. You seriously have to think and opt out. Because I'll tell you something, 50% of my housemen do not complete housemanship in 20. This is because they just cannot cope with the work. And that is the reality of it. So if you cannot cope, your father, mother, your alone, and PTPN is going to become a headache, not my headache. My headache is to ensure that you don't kill my patients. And it is true, ever since the new house officers coming, the amount of government compensation has gone through the roof. Millions of dollars are being paid. You sign up 1.5 million, 1.2 million for incompetent doctors. And that is why the government is now taking it very seriously that we cannot allow incompetent doctors the system, because it is somebody's life. No, that life could be one of your relatives' life. Please remember that. These people could be treating one of the loved ones, because every single patient is a loved one to somebody. And we cannot afford that to happen. No? So based on this, we went through various correction factors, and we decided for the time being, we'll still leave it at 1:4, because if we went to 1:8, you can find a good problem. Even at 1:4, you can see from the numbers, we have to remove about 2,000 house officers from the system, right? So we looked at it very seriously. We went through various correction factors, and you see what I meant. Because you see, we now have only 42 government hospitals. We're trying to increase it to other hospitals, because for a hospital to become a training hospital, it must have a minimum requirement of the 6 core disciplines with 2 consultants in each of the disciplines. Although the government has 144 hospitals, only 44 of them are suitable for houseman training. Otherwise, you will not have the case mix and the many other issues. Right? So you look at housemanship training, there are many hospitals in which you train all over the country, right? And this is what they said, we started with 5 postings, and now we've gone on for 2014, we've included primary care and psychiatry. Why have we included primary care? And because about 30% of medical students will end up becoming GPs. Or they want to do primary care. So unless we give them exposure and housemanship to what primary care is, it's unfair for them to suddenly end up being in primary care. So that is why you can go to primary care posting, provided you've done your medicine, your pediatrics, and your O&D posting. So you cannot go to primary care as a fresh houseman. Medical student, you must finish the medicine, just emergency medicine. You only go to emergency medicine after you finish the few of the mandatory postings. So this is to ensure patient safety. So now what has happened is that housemanship now has become almost like redoing medical school. So you've got case-based discussions, mini-CDECs, drops, and multi-source feedback. Why? Because we've got to ensure competency and we've got to ensure fairness in the process of ensuring housemen are trained properly. Now, when we started in 2011, many house officers came and complained to the parents that we were torturing them. Many of them complained that they were working too much and they said we cannot work more than 60 hours. And they looked at the law in the country that said maximum working hours is 60 hours. Unfortunately, this law only applies for manual laborers and those who earn less than 1,500. And so after I became deputy director general, I re-looked at the law and I told my husband, you want to work 60 hours, fine, I'll pay 1,500 and you return the manual laborer or domestic help. If you're a professional, the law does not apply to you. Okay, so many people have still got this idea that house officers cannot work more than 60 hours. Sorry, it is not true. Huh? It's a labor law that's only for manual workers. And if your salary is less than 1,500. Huh? So if you're a government servant, house officer and a professional, there's no such thing as minimum time. Okay, but don't worry, we're not that bad. Okay? So we went and looked at it. Because of the 60 hours, there are segmented working schedules, there are no ownership of patients, there's no continuity of care, exposure to clinicals were bad. So we modified the flexi hours, and what we did was, it went through a series. So you can see, nothing is done on an emotional basis. Everything is done on a rational basis, and you can see the number of meetings that I had to chair before we came down to the bottom of the line to come back. So it is not easy. It is not easy. It is very difficult because we have to, because you see, when you're the guardian of medical profession and the standards of the country, you have to be sure that whatever we do will stand the test of time. And when the flexi hours were introduced a few years ago, they were done on an emotional basis because of the extreme pressure from children of senior civil servants. And that was the biggest problem. No? To me, it doesn't matter who you are, who your father is. It is the law that is the law. Because I come from a very prominent family. My father was one of the few people with transit who started medical training in this country. So I know all this about medical training. No? So nobody can intimidate me. Right? Nobody can intimidate me. Because everything we do is based on rational basis and numbers. Because to me, you cannot manage something that you cannot measure. So if you can measure it, and you can show people you can measure it, and why we need to do it, there's no reason why people will not accept it. And so we went through major issues, and finally we came up with this. If you look at this, this is the current flexi hours. And you look at it very carefully. Look at the green. This is the office hours that you work, and you work 8 hours. Right? Fine. Now, if you do what is known as the extended hours, you work 14 hours, and you work till about 10 p.m. at night. If you do flexi 3, you work office hours, you're given time out, and then you come back and work at night, and the next morning you're around. So in the morning, all house officers are actually in the hospital. This gives you accountability. Otherwise, you'll say, no, I didn't clock this patient, my friend clocked last night. I don't know what's wrong. That is not excusable. No? Because your patient is your patient. And you have to learn whether you did the right diagnosis, whether you missed the liver, whether you missed a murmur, whether you miss the CNS, like I got a houseman who gave me an upgoing implanter on an artificial leg. Must be a very bionic leg. Artificial leg can have an upgoing implanter. Obviously, they did not examine the patient. Huh? Right, and that is a major problem. If you don't examine a patient, that is equivalent to you being dismissed. Because there is gross professional negligence. And house officers don't realize that, but we counsel them and tell them we told them that in the future. Right? Some people cheat, but they don't realize cheating in medicine is a serious crime. No? So with this system, we have worked it out that on an average, they will work between 65 to 75 hours. So it depends, because this flexi system is being done in such a way that is repeated over one whole month of 4 weeks, and we found that by that system you work between 65 to 75 hours, which is an acceptable hour because you have 1.5 years off. 1.5 years off, no? Which is more than enough for most people. No? Why do we do that? We worked it on this norm that a 30-bedded ward would have 1:4. For a 30-bedded ward, we will give you 10 medic house officers. 3 of them will do the office hours, 2 of them will do the 7 p.m. This will do the night, 2 of them will be off, and 1 is a replacement because all of you are entitled to take your leave. Right? So if somebody takes leave, this person down here will be the one that will be able to sort it. Otherwise, you know, if you don't have a correction factor of this person, when somebody goes and leaves, the rest of them will say, I can't cope. Right? Okay. So based on this, like I said, the correction factor, we did many things and we count the correction factor. But then we actually had a problem. Because you see, if you look at the correction factor, when we looked at 1:4 for medical beds, we realized something. The practice of general surgery, ONG, is very different because it has moved up. In general surgery, a lot of work is also done in the OT, a lot of work is done in emergency OT, and you also have to see patients in other places. With ONG, a lot of work is also done in the labor room. So because of that, we had to correct the correction factor. If you see here, from 1:4, in general surgery, we made it 1:4, 1.5, 1.6, so we actually did a lot of correction factors. So you can see, everything was done to correct things. So if you look at this, if you take Klang Hospital, when we work with the current ratios of 1:3.3, you can see that in medicine, there are 72 house officers. In surgery, there were 41. My question is, how do you push 72 officers into 41? If all the 41 house officers from this department went there, they'll be dead. Yeah, they'll be dead. Because remember, you're playing musical chairs, and you're moving every 4 months. Yeah, so if you did this, suddenly these people will go there and they say, I just cannot cope, because they'll now be working international norms of 1:8. But in their mind, I can't cope. But in reality, you should be able to cope. But never mind. So they're quite rational about it. What we did was, when we did the correction factor, you now can see that the numbers are almost the same. Now when we did the correction factor of 1:4, and started using the correction factor of 1:5 in between and calculate, so you can see it's not easy. We did this for every single hospital, every single department, so now I can move you from one department to another department without much problems. So I can take everybody from one department and move. Of course, there'll be some stragglers who will fail the assessment, they'll be left behind. Some people may meet with an accident and get offended and see. Some people may get pregnant and default the system. But we have to accept that in general, most people will be able to move. So if you look at this, and look at certain hospitals, I've highlighted two of them, Kulim and Sebrang there. Why have I highlighted that? Because you look at the number of beds, it's almost the same, but look at the number of doctors they have. You know, the number of doctors are far more. So when you do a correction factor and bring the numbers safe, you suddenly realize that this hospital got 82 extra doctors and this hospital got 62 less. Right? So that is why in some hospitals, if the colleagues who are working and housemen will tell you they've been killed, they're dying, true, because there has been a disproportionate number. These numbers were done basically based on two things, historically and based on the pengara shouting the loudest. The pengara shouted the loudest, said, I need more doctors, we just gave it to them. But in reality, we can't do that. Look at Penang Hospital. Penang Hospital got 140 extra doctors. 140 of them, because they were given 510 based on whatever norms they were given there. You look at HKL, they got 700 doctors, they were almost 100 extra, right? Yeah, so by this rationalization, tomorrow nobody can turn around and say, I cannot cope, because everybody is going to be given a fair deal, whichever hospital it is. So can you imagine, we had to do this for 44 hospitals with 9 disciplines. So there's a lot of homework, a lot of hard work, not a set in here, but we finally got to where we are. Okay, so now we can see here. So now this balances our housemanship training. Because you see, to me, if you're going to be trained as a houseman, you must have adequate exposure to various procedures. There's some housemen who have no exposure to any procedure at all, because there are too many of them. You can't do a lumbar puncture, you can't do a pleural tap, you can't do many things that you're supposed to do, but you cannot do because there are too many people competing for too little procedures. So what we did was, there's been induction course of housemanship at various levels, and then we have now decided the induction course would be slightly different. Apart from being taught the basic things of administration, we're going to teach you various other things, housemanship, like clerking patients. So because for those students who come from certain universities abroad, they're not used to clerking patients. Yesterday, I was interviewing a house officer who quit from the service after 1.5 years, he's come back, and he tried to do many jobs. For 1.5 years, he couldn't find a job. He's married, his wife is a teacher, sitting in front of me and crying, because for 1.5 years, he knocked on many doors, and nobody gave him a job. When I asked him what was his problem, he said, I don't know how to clerk a patient. Because he came from Indonesia, and they treated him extremely difficult. So in his first month of housemanship, he resigned. And these are the stories. There are many housemen I've got. All this, because to me, any houseman who resigned and wants to come back, I will interview them personally now. I'm quite surprised some of them have been selling socks, pasar malams. Some of them have been selling shoes in shoe shops. Some of them have been working in cyber cafes. One of them worked as an air hostess, not Air Asia, but on a budget airline, which was on a PRN basis. So you can see that many of these people, once they drop out from the system, it is very difficult to get a job. So far, the medical training is the only one that guarantees you a job. No? But if you drop out of the system, you realize how difficult it is to get a job out there, despite the fact that you are a doctor. Even when you clinical research in Malaysia, and CRM said, sorry, we will not employ you until you're fully registered. And so you can understand, it's very difficult, so do not waste the opportunity that is given to you. No? So there are various levels of housemanship training that we do, and there are various things that we have. But we've got a medical qualifying board, which is chaired by the Director General of Health. Then we've got a medical review panel that reviews the ability to work, because a large number of them actually have got various forms of psychiatric stress. And the commonest problem is adjustment disorder. A large number of them, I think about 20-25% of them, have an adjustment disorder. Why? Because from a medical student, you suddenly become a houseman. And I know why. I'm looking at the results, I know why. When I was a student, I used to study easily 15-16 hours a day to get the A's award. And when you become a doctor, you work the same amount. Even now, the Deputy Director General has to work on average 16 hours a day. 12 hours in the office, the rest of the time at home, clearing my emails and other things. So that's what life is all about. You want anything less than that, you can't do medicine. And I do active calls, so now you can understand why you have to work so many hours a day to produce the papers that produce, otherwise you will not be able to come to that level. One of the things they didn't tell you was that I was the first Malaysian and the first Asian to get a distinction from the University of London in thoracic medicine. And nobody has repeated that effort till now. And that is how difficult you have to work, right? You have to work extremely hard to come to that level of international recognition. So if you want to do medicine, for many of these people went in, I'll show you with some of the results they went in, I'm not surprised they cannot cope, because some of them have made some unbelievable results. So we've got books for housemanship training to try and educate you in what you need to do, right? And of course, this is the problem. The minimum entry qualification has been put into place, but you will see that this is a graduate from a medical college, I won't say from where, who got all sevens, the 777s and 999s, and came out with a medical degree from a so-called recognized college and couldn't complete housemanship. So now we know why the problems are. Huh? And now we know why we want all A's. If we're from Adiba, not here, but from Adiba, I'll tell you that even in MU, with all A pluses, you still get candidates who drop out. So getting all A pluses does not necessarily mean you can cope with medicine. Medicine is very different. That is why, you know, the attrition rate for every single MU student that drops out is $1 million for the government and Malaysia wasted. And our idea is, how can you not waste this? In Ireland, if you look at it, there are only 350 seats for medicine. 5,000 people applied. Out of the 5,000, apart from your academic qualification, they give you various aptitude testing. I worked in Ireland for a long time, so I know. It's very difficult to get into medicine in Ireland. Because you've got to do an aptitude test. You may have all the A's, but the aptitude may be wrong, and they will not teach you again. No? And I think MU is moving towards multiple forms of aptitude testing. And because medical education is very expensive. And you cannot have attrition. It's worse when people become doctors, housemen, and then doctors. So this is why I understand. A person who gets this kind of results, I'm sure they never studied more than 5-6 hours a day. They're lucky they ever went to school. But when you come and start working as a doctor, with all the implications that you have, and most housemen actually collapse where? in pediatrics and in general medicine, because those are the most demanding housemanship postings. Because you have to track patients, you have to do physical exam. Orthopedics is quite straightforward. Look at the x-ray and make sure you don't have a right or left disorientation problem. And put the x-ray right. Some of them will put the x-ray, which is the fracture of the brain, on the left, and the poor patient ends up with a plaster on the wrong foot. Happened many times. Okay? But this is the problem that we have. So now, what are we doing? We're trying to look at various ways of addressing this. Because the SPA takes students on a regular basis throughout the year. But look at problems with this. Because if we take students throughout the year, they come to the hospital at irregular intervals, it's very difficult for us to actually give you an induction course. So now we're thinking of only taking people every 2 months. So that there'll be critical numbers enough for us to give you a course process induction, and then it'll be better. Like I said, the maldistribution house officers, they've gone through various things, they've decided to regularize it, so there will not be a problem of too many or too little in some hospitals. This is the one I talked to you about, various things. You can skip this. Yeah, strengthen then in the orientation program, right? Even for tagging now, they're making sure that when you finish tagging, there has to be objective parameters to finish tagging. Like the Department of Medicine HK, for tagging, the period is for 2 weeks, but if you're smart enough, you can complete it earlier, because I believe in competency-driven and not time-based movements. If you're competent, you can off-tag faster. What you need to do, you need to plug 2 patients and present it to us. Then you need to examine the 4 basic systems, the respiratory system, the cardiovascular system, the abdomen, and the CNS, observed by one of the consultants or specialists. And if you can do that, then fine. And the final test is to be shown a series of blood results and x-rays with you as a house officer will be exposed in the middle of the night. If you can make rational decisions on those, then you're allowed to continue with working as a house officer. But some of them were taking for almost 1 month. And because they're just incompetent, they're not safe. Huh? Because if you're not safe, we cannot let you go on. These are other problems. The house officers absent with an approval leave and entitlement. This is because of stress, and they leave the system. And because of this problem, many of them leave halfway, and because they are actually permanent staff, it results in the difficulty of new posting house officers into the department. And because you see, once you're a permanent staff, your name is on the roll to be sacked, and it may take 2 years for you to be sacked. For 2 years, that post cannot be filled, and the department will have a major problem because on paper, there's somebody on the post. But in reality, there's nobody. There's a virtual or there's a phantom houseman. So in order to overcome this, we've decided that any house officer that disappeared for more than 2 months, the name will be removed from the hospital and put into a holding pool so that I can fulfill that post. Otherwise, this is a problem. It becomes a real problem for people working on the ground. Like I said, overseas colleges, we must look at various forms, and we are going to various things and having a meeting tomorrow with both the Civil Service and Public Service Commission on this. To say that if you do not have an NOC or if you do not have minimum standards, you will not be employed by us. Right? Okay, these are other things they're thinking of. Should we do compulsory HIV, hepatitis B, and hepatitis C screening for new officers? I think we need to, because some of them we know are hepatitis positive, HIV positive. And we've got specific guidelines for allowing house officers to do housemanship if they have got any one of these diseases. Because we understand some of them. It's quite dangerous if you have any of the diseases and you don't declare it and you pass it on to a patient, that is criminal. But we will facilitate your training. Urine for drug tests, yes. You have house officers who are very, very willing to help nurses give morphine because they're giving morphine to themselves. It is true. We've got many of them. They're drug dependents and they work in the emergency department, and you find why my patient is not responding to the morphine, you realize the house officer has been injecting it into himself or herself. So this happens. There's a lot of problems. The problems are quite great, because they come from various colleges with various kinds of problems. Many of them are drug dependent. That's why, and the other thing is that, should we screen them for major psychiatric illnesses? Because as a house officer, or as a doctor, if you've got a psychiatric problem, there are 2 issues. First is that, are you stable as a patient? Second, are you reasonably competent to practice as a doctor? I'm sure many of you have done a psychiatric posting. Many of the psychiatric patients are stable. You go back in the community. But are they safe enough to practice as a doctor? Would you want one of them treating you or your relatives? That is the real question we have to ask. And that is why we have major issues to do all of this. And that is why we have a medical review panel, the MMC, that will review the capacity and ability of these people to work. Now, like I said, there are many things that we're doing. On average, we can take 600,000 officers. Unfortunately, now I cannot. Now, many of them are queuing. And many people don't want to go to Sabah, Sarawak, because I don't know why. It's actually a very nice place to go. I urge all of you to go and see. Some of the hospitals are far better than the hospitals in Malaysia. I don't know why people want to go to Kajang Hospital with falling over patients. And you can go to Sabah and Sarawak to go to the place where we do a carpet or canoe, which is a fantastic hospital, $300-400 million hospital, state of the art. Get people to want to go. Right? Like I said, opening up all these hospitals, all these hospitals are fantastic hospitals. When you go there, you'll see they're fantastic hospitals. State of the art, but not enough people. Okay? They're all fantastic. You know, much better. Look, hospital Sarikay looks far better than many hospitals you can see. Hospital Kintulu, everyone, they took a night shot. Trying to entice you to the nightlife in Kintulu. Many of our hospitals, they're actually very good. People think Sabah Sarawak is a forgotten trophy, right? It is not. Right? Okay? Like I said, we've gone through various things of increasing the number of beds, like I said, improving, right? And the faxing system, the generic framework that can be used in all hospitals, right? This is one house officer who wrote this in March of 2013, fully endorsing that we should increase the working hours. And now here everybody is saying we can't increase the working hours, but this person, so we decided to cut it and show it to everybody. Okay? Like I said, now the work within 65 to 75 hours, right? And the many things. They're giving various things. Don't worry, you're not slave drivers. So they give you enough time off to do things. You've got public holidays for which you get time off. You get protected time to study. In the bottom, you can see, you ensure the protected time you give the CME. And you must attend 75% of the CME, otherwise you do not move forward. So there are various things that have been done to improve working conditions. Like I said, you want to strengthen and do. Everybody must have a BLS before you go into the system, right? You've got books which are very specific, the objectives, so that nobody can say that I don't want to extend somebody or don't like somebody's face, right? And it happens to all kinds of things. I get complaints from house officers saying the consultant doesn't like a certain rate, the bias against a certain rate, they don't like my face, they don't like my smell, they don't like the fact that I come in a car with more expensive than the consultant's fare. True, Some of my house officers are very rich, our parents are very rich, they come to work in cars. They are embarrassed many of our consultants. It is true. It is true. I one house officer, I tried to counsel him or her, but punching out and they need to do it to claim money. He said, I don't need this money. My father gives me 10,000 a month pocket money. So what do I do with those kind of patients? House officers will treat my nurses like maids because after they do a procedure, they throw everything and expect the nurses to clean up. It is not your maid to clean up. And you've got a certain trend that these house officers come from certain universities. I'm not going to tell you which university because we have discovered they don't come from public universities, they come from private universities where the fees are very high. So obviously you have to have a lot of fees, part of the head to bank balance, and you can see the car that they drive there. It would be quite interesting. Okay, so now let's move on to the final part of my lecture, career development and doctors. Like I said, we went through the whole continuum. And you know, this is what happens. You begin, and you finally become a butterfly. So when you start this life, you're always out there. Okay? As you develop over the years, you begin to metamorphosize and begin to become something at the end of the day. It's not that easy, but it's a very slow process. But I show you a more interesting slide towards the end. Okay, so now I think the most important thing is that you must become a doctor for the right reason. And like I said, those graduates from recognized medical colleges are fine. Those from non-recognized colleges have to sit for a medical qualifying exam. And like I said, if Oxford and Cambridge doesn't want to be endorsed by us, you also have to sit for a qualifying exam. But it'll be a walk in the park for you anyway. So what's the big deal? Then you get a temporary practicing certificate at MMC. And when you go for a job interview and application, you go to the Public Service Commission, and they'll interview you. And then you'll wait endlessly for 6 months to 1 year before you get a job, unfortunately. And then when we give you a job, there'll be this big hoo-ha, I don't want to go to this hospital, I don't want to go there, appeal after appeal. And the politician will write an appeal, you look for somebody, and it goes on. But very simple, even my minister's daughter is in Sarawak. Right? And the chief secretary's son is also somewhere. So all the senior civil servants draw the line, there must be something extremely special about you as to why you cannot go to a peripheral hospital. Okay? Then you make placement depending on vacant post and training hospital, you go to the induction course. Right? Like I said, you have to do 2 years of compulsory service. You can do it in any one of these. Right? Apart from the Ministry of Health, there are many other places where you can also do compulsory service. Right? Okay? And then you've got time-based promotion. But the master's program, you apply after 1 year, you enter the master's program, you 1,000 plus per year, your parallel pathway, you can do various other exams, you do parallel pathway. And some of my housemen actually, during the housemanship, they passed the MRCT part 1 and the part 2. They passed. Some of them are smart enough, they can pass. So there's no reason why you cannot pass if you want to do it. Master's program is received by 22 different sub areas of the master's program. It is matured over the years. The master's program is about 25 years old. There's some issues, we're re-looking at it, because as time goes, you have to change it. Understand, in medicine, you've got to change it, because things will change from time to time, no? Because medicine is not static, it's very dynamic. So you've got to change the program, you've got to change the syllabus to address the changing practice of medicine. You cannot do something 25 years ago. No, none of your lectures are doing that. All the slides are obsolete. But some of them do, you know. Right? So we encourage you to take part one of equivalence so that you can be passed. And what we now have the division under me, that those of you who have passed, we will facilitate and not frustrate you. If you pass the part one, we will make sure that you go into a training program as fast as possible. Because, like I said, I believe in competency and not time-based. If you're competent, we will fast track you. Okay? So basically, in the subspecialty training program, we're trying to shorten the period, and you can see that we're trying to actually shorten the period. Unfortunately, certain of those which are procedure-driven, hepatology, gastroenterology, urology, cardiothoracic surgery, may take 4 years instead of 3 years. Because it's driven by procedures. So they want longer time of hands-on experience. Now, if you look at the subspecialties, they're actually very well developed. So you can look at it. Because all the subspecialties in surgery, you've got 12 subspecialties, ophthalmology, you've got 7, psychiatry, you've got 7, nevertheless, psychiatry, you've got so many subspecialties. They do. Pathology has got 7 or 6, forensic medicine has got nuclear medicine, anesthesia, general medicine, of course, pediatrics, you can do it. So there's many, many subspecialties available for training. All of this can be done locally. There's no need for you to go overseas. Like I said, medical education, lifelong learning. You start with 5 years, then you become a medical officer, then you become into the master's of parallel pathway. And we're trying to see whether we actually shorten this a bit. We're trying to see, but there are various issues. In order to shorten it, fortunately, the DG of health in Singapore is my classmate. He's a neurologist. So we both studied together in Singapore for a while. And both of us feel that there has to be a shortening of this process, but we cannot compromise your clinical skills. So the only way that can happen is if the medical officer training and the health officer training is very robust. If it is very robust, only then you can shorten it. If it is not robust, the dangers of what happens now, which is one of my biggest problems. But dengue is one of the other areas of my specialization, and we find that in the private sector, people who learned how to manage dengue 20 years ago are managing them and killing patients. There are more dengue deaths in private hospitals than in government hospitals. Why? Because neurologists and nephrologists who never treated dengue for the last 20 years are treating dengue now. Because it is money in their pocket. But they're killing patients. So this is a danger because they do not have a robust knowledge of general medicine. And it has changed over the years. Issues and challenges, like I said, this is my biggest problem. The master's program, only 38% of them graduate on time. So that means to say those who enter the master's program are not the best. You'll notice that I will show you the number of specialists we need, the huge numbers that we need, the numbers that we're producing, there's a big shortfall, right? And you can see, if you look at the master's program, MRCP produces more candidates a year than the MM program. Why? Because in MRCP, you're paying out of your pocket. Yeah? And you realize that if you pass the MRCP part one, 85% of them will pass the MRCP final exam. It comes out of your pocket. The MM is the other way around. Only 25% will pass. Yeah, so this is one of the biggest problems. So we are reviewing all of this. And that is why we are encouraging parallel pathway. Because the parallel pathway encourages those of you who are smarter and more competent to move faster. Like I said, there's no reason why you should be held back. If you want to zoom along a highway, we should let you go. Don't get stuck in the traffic there. Now what I believe is that if you are an eagle among turkeys, the eagle will be allowed to soar and leave the turkeys behind. Right? Okay, so for those who have passed the part one, like I said, there are many ways of facilitating movement. Right? Like I said, there are many issues that we have to address. But I think one of the things that we are now completing is that we now have what is known as the National Specialist Register. In the National Specialist Register, if you want to maintain yourself as a general physician, you've got to prove to us that 30% of your work on a daily basis is general work. So cardiologists cannot claim to be a general physician, come cardiologist, until and unless he or she probes this, and same with neurology and anything. Same with general pediatrics. We have to ensure patient safety. That is the other area of my concern, is patient safety. So when we look at manpower planning, we've gone through the whole lot, and you can see it is a major challenge for us to do what we need to do. Like I said, with the moratorium, there are many issues we can talk about in the questions you can ask me. Then employment house officers, right? Last few slides. Essential for student instruction obtained, not in the lecture room, but on the side. So there's no shortcut to medicine. You have to go to bed, you have to practice it. And the important thing is to make a lesson of each case, tell on education. This is Sir William Austin. So you know that every single case is a challenge. And they're not similar. They may be identical, but each one of them has got something different. Now this is very interesting. Levels of competency. As a medical officer, you're unconsciously incompetent. Because you think everything you do is fantastic and right. Until somebody comes like me and scolds you, then you become consciously incompetent. Right? And when you're a specialist, you're consciously competent. Right? But when you become a subspecialist or an expert like me, you're unconsciously competent. Because when you come to that level, whatever you do is competent. Because you've gone through the learning scale. And this is true of medicine. No? And so those of you, I don't know what medical students are, unfortunately. The lowest of the species, we do not talk about. This is Darwin's theory of evolution. So the lowest of the species, I decided not to give you a name. No, but it is true, you know, because if you look at this, as you go through, it's true. When you give a house officer an ECG, he's going to look at it and say, it's a PQRST, and where's the Q wave, or what is that? By the time you go to a medical officer, he'll be able to tell something. By the time you give the specialist, it is a pattern recognition. You look at the pattern and you say, this is inferior infarction, this is atrial fibrillation, this is something, right? When you come to my level, it is beyond pattern recognition. You look at the pattern and you have what is called intuition. And you will tell that this patient is going to survive or this patient is going to die, not on the ECG, but on many other multiple inputs. And that is what medicine is all about. Learning as you go on and on. So don't be surprised. Everybody says that you want the most accurate diagnosis, ask the house officer. He will give you the most accurate diagnosis because in his or her mind, that is the only diagnosis. But you go to the consultant, there are multiple questions asked and multiple possibilities. Right? Okay, well, then thank you very much. For people to be employed in America. So my suggestion, or I would say it should be in your mind to think of doing the USMLE and going to America. Because the opportunities are there. There are many opportunities there. And because here you can see, our programs are saturated. You have to be good to get in, right? But that doesn't mean that you cannot survive as a specialist in this country. You can. We're going to go into the American residency program. It's very different because I'm quite deeply involved with Padana University and the residency program. No? Now, the residency program in Padana University, the first group will only come out next year. But unfortunately, we're not going to allow them to do the shortened residency program. Now, because in Singapore, like I said, the Duke NUS system has got a shortened residency program that is beginning to show some defects in its running of the program. And so the Singaporeans also are really, because in the Singapore government, their Singapore Medical Council Act also mandates you have to do 12 months of housemanship. So what the Singaporeans have done is that you have to do 12 months of housemanship, but let us say you do a residency in medicine, your last posting in medicine. So you may do, let's say, OMG, you may do pediatrics. Your last posting, after 8 months, you begin your last posting in medicine, will begin to become the beginning of the residency in internal medicine. So that means they actually shorten it to 8 months housemanship. But that has got some limitations. So I was just talking to my friend, and he's seriously concerned. Many of us think that the American residency program may not be what we want in this country. But if you want to work in America, fine, because in America, the system is such that you go to the residency program, then you do a sub-specialization. So your residency program is 4 years, your sub-specialization or fellowship in whatever you want to do is another 3 years, there is another place. So that is one option. It's an option you can pursue, but you have to do USMLE. So you want to do it, I encourage you to do it, no problem.
So you're saying for students who are interested to be educated, the US should not come back to Malaysia? And
yeah, there's some of the Malaysians who are working there, because every Malaysian who works there will get a letter signed by me to say that we're allowing them to work in the US, right? And there's a letter that we have to sign off on them. Many of them are doing residency programs. So I got one person from Sabah who actually finished the MRCP, completed the MRCP, and wanted to go in the US residency program in internal medicine. I thought it was rather weird of him, having already got the MRCP and then going back to start from ground zero, but he wanted to go and we let him go. I explained him in the council hearing that it was actually not worth it to do what he wanted to do, but his family is in America and he wanted to go back, so he didn't mind wasting 4 more years. But look at the US residency program training, it is quite, I think they're far more advanced. I can tell this from you because I interact with those who come and join talking the residency program. Our doctors know far more than that in terms of managing patients because they're more holistic in overall management of patients. They don't get compartmentalized. Any questions? Don't hesitate, you better ask why. Well, it's going good. Yes, come. The same?
Yes.
Well, yeah, housemanship in Sabah and Sarawak, we send you. The real problem in Sabah and Sarawak is medical offices. People don't want to go to Sabah and Sarawak. Housemanship, most of them will go because they know it's a 2-year posting. But even for medical offices, we make it a 2-year posting. Even a specialist is a 2-year posting. Now we guarantee that we'll bring you back after 2 years. But some of them don't want to come back after 2 years. But well, life is so good there. I think the success rate, if you ask me, those who go to Sabah, Sarawak are better trained because the exposure to procedures is far higher. In fact, many of my consultants in Sabah and Sarawak tell me, please don't take my husband back after 2 years because you've trained them so well, they're fantastic, you want them to work here. And it's true actually, those who go to Sabah, Sarawak actually come back with greater hands-on experience. I would really urge those of you who want to do housemanship, you should go to Sabah. Any more questions?
Yes.
Concerns of the master's program. The master's program, unfortunately, is designed only for the local intake. Right? So that is what I normally advise all the people in the master's program, especially internal medicine, to get dual certification. You can do the MRCP, either UK or Ireland. I run the Irish MRCP here. You do all parts part one to the clinical exams here. So we normally recommend that you do them both simultaneously in internal medicine. In pediatrics, you also do the MRCPH, UK simultaneously. It is the surgical based discipline that we're having a problem now. And I think we're in advanced negotiations with the Royal College of Surgeons in the UK to bring back the FRCS. Because FRCS has slowly died a natural death. Because the FRCS, is natural death because you know what? You need trainers. And you need credential trainers. So there were not many people left in the country at the FRCS UK or Glasgow Edinburgh to be trainers. But we have now worked out a system where they recognize some of the university lecturers and government surgeons as trainers. So once we do that, then you can do the FRCS, you can do the MRCS Part A, Part B, you can do the FRCS International. But like I said, the FRCS International is just a piece of paper. It is just a credential that you are got to a certain level. Then in the UK, just what we are going to propose here is that you're going to do your CCST, which is the completion of specialist training, certificate of completion. Now, the CCST may go on for something like 24 or maybe 36 months. It depends on what you're doing. Okay? So that will be an alternate or parallel pathway for those who want to do surgery. And I think it is important because look at the master's program for surgery. There's a great limitation in the number of people who can do surgical-based master's program. Yeah, so that would be. So I strongly feel that with globalization, everybody should have an internationally recognized degree. I'm not saying that a master's program is not the best, but in Singapore for many years when I was working there, when you did the MMAT in Singapore, you actually set for the MRCP or the MRCP simultaneously, so you came up with dual certification. But if you didn't want to sit, they didn't stop you from not sitting, so you just pay for one exam. But most Singaporeans pay for both exams, and anybody who sat, they set for both exams. So that should be the way forward. No more? Fine, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jaya, for that very interesting and providing us with such a good reality of the situation of the medical condition in Malaysia. And I hope that we, as the lowest of the species, are much more aware now of the challenges ahead in the Malaysian medical healthcare system, as well as the gargantuan task placed on the shoulders of the Malaysian healthcare system. So with that, let's give him another round of applause, please. Thank you for spending your time with us. I'd like to invite Lau Ziyang to present us, to present Dr. Jaya with a token of appreciation on behalf of MMI and Talent Corps.